everyone. Thanks for joining in. In this episode, I'd like to talk about creating your own custom borders or frames. Now, there's plenty to choose from within the software. There's the rope border and the chain border and the bobbed wire. And of course, we can create borders and frames with the two-rail sweep. But the ones I'm looking for are slightly different. Slightly, shall we say, twisted. In the Aspire software, you can create many different shapes. Through this, I'll show you how you can use the power of the software to create your own custom border or frame. It's not hard, it just takes a little bit of thinking. You can also add extra components, if you want, to those frames to make a unique item for sale or for a gift. So let's get started. We're going to open a new session of Aspire. It will be a 24-inch by 24-inch by 1-inch XY datum in the center, very high resolution for the model. I'd like to create an 18-inch circle right in the center of my workspace. That's the size of the frame that I'm looking to make. The important aspect of this is to know the length of the circle, the perimeter or circumference. I click on the measuring tool and I can see that the measurement of my circle is listed here. That's important. We probably should write that down somewhere so we don't forget. We open a new session of Aspire, but this time it's going to be a rotary project. And the length is going to be that magic number, 56.549, that we got from the perimeter of our circle. 3-inch diameter material. The rest is your choice, the Z0, XY, orientation, and of course, modeling resolution. We hit OK. I want to create a shape from some vectors that will be more like a profile. We're going to just choose some circles, a 1-inch circle, and I'm going to offset it. Minus 0.375 in the X and positive 375 in the Y. I click on that and I want to mirror it around the center. Basically flip it over, but make a copy. So now I have two circles overlapping. I copy those and I'm going to flip them vertically. So now I have four interlocking circles. I'm going to add a little bit more detail. Again, another circle, this time a quarter of an inch. I'm going to place it right in the center of the Y-axis. The key thing to know here is that when I move it down, the center point of the circle has to be below the corresponding larger circles. Otherwise, you get an undercut, which is problematic in the software. I'm going to take that circle and rotate it four times around the center of my workspace. Eight circles. I select those eight circles and I'm going to weld them together. I hit the weld button twice because there's a little artifact left in the center. So now I have a nice welded shape of my original eight circles. Within the rotary setup, there is a tool to unwrap my closed vector. This now becomes the profile that I'm going to be using when I use the tool of extrude and weave. I create a single vector vertically, top to bottom, full length, of my workspace. Click on the extrude and weave icon. Select that new vector. That will be the rail that I'm going to use. I select my unwrapped profile of the vectors that we have. Change the component property to merge and press apply. Take a look at it in the 3D view. It's nice. but it's not twisted. I'll show you how we can do that. Take a look at the shape of it all, and it looks what I expected it to be. Here's the trick on how you can take a shape in the rotary session of a spire and rotate it around your stock material. I take my top horizontal vector and I copy it to the right 3 times because I want my component to wrap around my material 3 times. I now need to get some measurements. I need the angle as well as the length. So to get the measurement of the angle, I choose the dimensions so I can remember what the numbers are. Select the bottom corner, up to the right, over to the left. My angle is 26.565 degrees. I'm going to use my length dimension in my dimension tool. The top right-hand corner to the bottom left-hand corner. (63.2237 inches). These are important numbers. I now need to make my component larger. I'm going to click on the component and choose the set size just to increase the component in the Y direction, not the X and not the Y. I now need to rotate it by that 26.565 degrees. And it's going to be a negative rotation, which means it will rotate in the clockwise direction. Once we hit apply, we can see that our component has been rotated. Now there's one additional step we need to take. We need to extend it out even further than what it is. Increase the length. We have the vectors at the top, so we can click on our component and simply drag it out so the top right corner of the component matches our vector. This is important, and the more accurate you can be at matching the corner to the vector, or the line, the better your end product will be. We go down to the bottom of the component, and now the bottom left corner of the component needs to match the guideline that we set up. Right there. That's our component that will wrap around 3 times and meet up with itself perfectly. We can preview it in the 3D view, but we only see one portion of it. We need to go to our levels and right click and change it to wrapping. We can preview it as a rotary object. Sometimes if there's a slight overlap of the wrapping, you'll get some anomalies. You can adjust the width of your component to eliminate that, or if it's slight enough, you can simply click on the level and change the component property to merge, and that'll solve that problem. Now we have our twisted component. If you're happy with that, the next step would be to export it as an STL file. We want to triangulate and we want to save it to a known location, a place you can find it again. I named this one Rope. close this. We can save this file because we're finished here. We go back to our original file with our 18-inch circle. Again, we're going to check that number because I forgot to write it down. Because now this number comes into play again. We're going to import our newly made STL file of the rope, as I call it. We'll center it within the material. And what that does is it splits it halfway, top and bottom, and also centers it in the X and Y. At this point, I can change the length of it, the Y, within this portion of the software to that magic number that we've talked about before, the 56. I don't want to change the X, and I don't want to change the Z. Simply hit apply, and if it's everything else is okay, click OK. Or I could have just simply imported it, selected it, gone to set size of that component, and adjusted the dimensions there. Again, we're only changing the Y direction, the Y measurement. If we're happy with that, we can click on it. Now I'm going to use the extrude and weave, so the component needs to be in the horizontal position for it to be accurate. I click on the extrude and weave icon within the software. I choose the circle as my rail. I'm going to choose the component, the rope, as the item to be extruded around that circle. Hit apply. We can preview it in the 3D view, but first let's get rid of our horizontal component. It's not necessarily what I wanted to see. And there's our twisted border or frame, custom made. It all depends upon that profile vector that you've created. Here's something I cut out just the other day. The 3D model in the center comes from Design and Make. I incorporated that with my new rope model, and I thought it came out rather attractive. Here's the link to the model. So, if you like what you've seen, please subscribe so you can be alerted of new videos coming out in the future. And of course, you can always email me if you have any questions. Thanks for watching.